Welcome to the annual Baltimore City Council's Taxpayer Night. This is a meeting of the Budget and Appropriations Committee, and I am Helen Holton, Councilwoman from the 8th District Chair of the Committee. Let me begin by introducing the members of the City Council. I am joined tonight by City Council President Bernard C. Jack Young, to my left, your right. Next to him is Councilman Jim Kraft, Vice Chair of the Committee. Councilwoman Mary Pat Clark from the 14th District. Councilman Kraft from the 1st District. Councilman Sharon Green Middleton from the 6th District, a member of the committee. Councilman Bill Henry from the 4th District. Council Vice President Ed Reisinger from the 10th District. And we have Mr. Larry Green, the Director of Council Services, Mr. Hosea Chu, Chief of Administration for the President's Office, Mr. Paul Plymouth, and Ms. Kara Kuntz from the President's Legislative Staff. To my right and your left, we have Ms. Marguerite Murray, staff to the committee, Councilman Brandon Scott from the 2nd District, Councilman Carl Stokes from the 12th District, Councilman Warren Branch from the 13th District, Councilman Nick Mosby from the 7th District.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Councilman Pete Welch from the 9th District.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Councilman Eric Costello from the 11th District, a member of the committee.
Thank you, ma'am.
And I've missed, okay.
You got us all.
Very good. Taxpayers Night provides the public an opportunity to comment on City Council Bill 15-532, the Ordinance of Estimates for the fiscal year ending on June 30th, 2016, and City Council Bill 15-33, the Annual Property Tax for fiscal year 2016. The preliminary fiscal year 2016 operating budget has been recommended at $2.55 billion. This is an increase of $88.1 million above the fiscal year 2015 adopted budget. The capital plan is recommended at $673 million, which is a decrease of $225 million. The members of the City Council are very interested in listening to your views and observations concerning this budget. Since we are here to listen, we do not intend to enter into dialogue with you as you speak, but may ask you to clarify a point. Anyone wishing to speak tonight must sign up to do so, and sign-up sheets are located at the table at the entrance of the chambers. Speakers will be heard in the order in which they have signed up. Each time I announce the name of the next speaker, I will identify the next person so you can prepare to come up to the microphone. And all speakers will need to come up to the podium and speak directly into the microphone to be heard. We ask that you limit your remarks to 2 minutes so that everyone can have an opportunity to speak. Time will be kept by DePaul Nibber here at this front desk. He will alert you when you have 30 seconds left by holding up a yellow paddle. At that time, you should start bringing your remarks to a close. He will alert you when you are out of time by holding up a red paddle. We ask that everyone adhere to these guidelines to allow everyone an opportunity to speak. If multiple persons from an organization or affiliated group are present, one representative must be designated to speak on behalf of that organization or group. No one will be permitted to yield their time to another presenter. As stated previously, all individuals will be permitted to testify only once. If you have points you wish to raise that cannot be addressed in the allotted 2 minute time period, we ask that you submit written testimony to committee staff at the hearing. If you have a handout or copy of your remarks in writing, please give them to Ms. Marguerite Murray, staff for the committee, who is sitting to my right, your left. She will distribute them to council members. I want to say that we've also been joined by Andy Smullian from the mayor's office, as well as Andrew Klein, the director of budget, director of the Bureau of Budget and Management Research, Ms. Angela Gibson from the mayor's office. And finally, we ask that everyone please turn off all cell phones and pagers. Please turn off all cell phones and pagers. And we will now begin. The first speaker, Rhonda Wimbush. And when you come to the microphone, please tell us what district you're from and if you have written testimony. And let me just say, written testimony is really important because it becomes a record of what we do here in City Hall so that your words will live on long before your presence before us this day. Following Ms. Wimbush will be Cynthia Swan. Ms. Wimbush.
Thank you. My name is Rhonda Wimbush. I'm a Black homeowner and property owner, Black parent with a school-age child, Black small business owner, community advocate, and Baltimore City surrogate parent. The Black community has the worst schools, most vacancies, highest crime, most foreclosures, and the highest water bills. Is it our Blackness that makes us the victim time and time again? Is it my Blackness that caused my property to be deeded to an investor that refused to cash my property tax redemption check? Specifically to the Black City Council members, what makes your Blackness not support our Blackness?
Cynthia Swan, followed by Marianne Hendricks. And please share with us your council district.
Good evening. My name is Cynthia Rogers Swan, out of Councilmatic District 8. I'm the facilitator of Tremont North and South Association. About a year ago, Baltimore City removed street cleaning from our community. Not a big deal for me because I believe that all homeowners should be responsible for the cleaning of their own property. But after they removed street cleaning, they implemented a third and fourth Wednesday odd and even street cleaning that most of the community did not know about. So on the third and fourth Wednesday of every month, I watch street cleaning vehicles just ride around my community when we have no playgrounds for the 10 daycare centers that exist in my community. And that is my question. Why are we revisiting street cleaning in the 8th Councilmatic District in the Tremont community? We took it out last year, and now we have people running around doing traffic studies to put signs back into the community to tell people to move on the third and fourth Wednesday. All of this is ridiculousness to me because we don't have any outside activity for any of the children in our community. And lastly, the proprietors of the corner stores in Baltimore City, none of which mostly look like me, but their patrons are everyone who looks like me, and they are being allowed to operate during school hours, totally dismissing the fact that our children belong in school. I've called about the one in my community on numerous occasions, and they totally ignore the law. When will they be held accountable for not servicing our children during school hours and making sure they go to school and get an education? Thank you.
Marianne Hendricks, followed by Hassan Giordano. Marianne Hendricks? Okay.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for letting me give my remarks. My name is Marianne Hendricks. I'm one of the administrators at Commodore John Rogers Elementary Middle School in Butchers Hill. Commodore is a community school in over by Hopkins in East Baltimore, and we're wrapping up our fifth year creating a successful turnaround school. I've worked at Commodore since 1999, first as a clinician, and since 2011 as on the administrative team. There would be more of our people here today to talk to you and to show an appearance, but right now, as we speak, there are 65 eighth graders graduating and participating in their gateway ceremony, and the rest of our staff and parents are supporting them. If I could take a moment to just say a little bit about Commodore. In 2010, Commodore was a failing school of just under 200 students, and we were tied for last in terms of citywide test scores. In just 5 years that we've been a turnaround school, enrollment has risen to just over 700 students, and we've increased test scores by 30%, or 30 points. Tonight, I'm representing those 700 plus students, along with their families, our partners, and stakeholders, and our staff of about 70 very committed educators. We are asking for your Your quick support to reverse recent district mandated changes that threaten the structure and staffing at our school that have made our students' successful gains possible. I'd like to read a letter from the students, parents, and stakeholders of our school. It will be submitted to Dr. Gregory Thornton, and they are raising their concerns about the proposed changes. I have a copy of the letter for each person, and I can leave that or I can hand them out.
You can leave it with Ms. Murray and she will distribute it.
Okay, would you like them like it now or? Okay.
It appears you're out of time.
So may I leave the letter?
Yes, you may.
And I just want to say that we're prepared to forward this letter with more than 1,000 signatures to Dr. Thornton, to the school board, and to the city council as a show of solidarity against these changes and a way to bring these issues to your attention.
Thank you. Hassan Giordano, followed by Stephanie Murdoch. Hassan Giordano. Okay, Stephanie Murdoch. Followed by Roxanne Allen.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to speak before you tonight. My name is Stephanie Murdoch. I'm the president of the Skate Park of Baltimore and as of last month, a homeowner in the 14th District. I'm a taxpayer, a city resident, and despite the heels, I'm a skateboarder. In full disclosure, I do work for the city of Baltimore, but I'm here tonight to talk about what we can do for the youth of the city. In light of the unrest, one cry that we've been hearing is that we need more recreation opportunities for our youth. On the evening of April 27th, when I drove home from City Hall, I admit I was scared. I had a community meeting that night, and due to the unrest in the city, I considered not going. That meeting was at the Roosevelt Recreation Center, and I just put on the best I could do and went down there. And know what I saw? There were children at the skate park. The recreation center was closed because of the unrest, but there was about 20 children at the skate park, and you know what? Those children looked exactly the same as the ones 2 miles away. On North Avenue, and the only difference is that they had recreation in their lives. They had a positive outlet, and nothing was going to stop them from going out and skateboarding that evening. Our budget has been stagnant since 1989, almost a quarter of a century, plus or minus $35 million for recreation in parks. I stood before the Board of Estimates on Taxpayers Night, and I stood before the Recreation and Parks Committee imploring them to increase the budget, add recreation and parks to the mayor's budget outcome for safer streets. Recreation and parks saves lives. Young people who are active, mentally and physically engaged in their community are less likely to involve themselves in drugs or crime. The kids tell me that the skate parks save their lives. And they told me they don't know where they would be without skateboarding. I wish I had a cute kid from Hamden up here that would say, oh man, I just wanna play skateboard. But unfortunately, it's just me. When are we going to do more than pay lip service to the facilities and the programs that our youth need? I'm a skateboarder, so I wanna concrete everything, but I understand the impact that all of recreation and parks has on our city. Thank you.
Roxanne Allen. Followed by Ellie Mitchell.
Good evening, Chairwoman Helen Holton, and President Jack Young, and all the council members.
Talk directly into the mic.
I will. I am Roxanne Allen, President of Baltimore Education Coalition, and I'm here with a humble heart to thank you all for the service that you have done today by committing $4.2 million to the out-of-school time and community school strategy. I've worked with the community school strategy since it began here in Baltimore in 2008, and I've and very dedicating and fulfilling to my life to support the children that we have promised to make sure they thrive and receive a wonderful education. That is the mission of the Baltimore Education Coalition, is to make sure that every child attending a Baltimore City public school receives an excellent education. And this year has been extremely difficult with during the legislative session. As you know, we have gone back time and time again with our governor asking for money, fighting for money, and we will continue to fight for our children. They deserve it. Where they cannot speak for themselves, we will speak for them, and we will continue tirelessly. We thank you, and we thank the mayor for you all making a very tough decision and finding a way to support community schools in out-of-school time. I know that there have been some concerns that I've heard just recently about how far does the money go. I do know, and I want to publicly say, that I know that some community schools do go year-round, because the organization that I work for, we have year-round community schools. So if there's more that needs to be looked into, that we could help with that. However, this is a wonderful occasion, and I want to acknowledge you all when you do wonderful work, and you've done wonderful work today. Thank you.
Thank you. Ellie Mitchell, followed by Tam Purnell.
Good evening, council members, I am very happy to see all of you, some of you whom I saw this morning. Again, I am the director of the Maryland Out of School Time Network, also known as MOST. I am also here tonight to thank you all for the work that you've done to increase the out of school time and community school investment. We all know what the benefits will be. I also, though, want to just remind us all that we have a long way to go on this road. The money will get us further, and it's a great down payment. But I'm standing tonight in my I Am Baltimore safe and sound shirt because it was a decade ago that the first investment in after school happened. And we haven't moved forward until now, until today, over that 10 years. And I don't want to stand for another 10 years before we move even further. So I want to thank you guys for what you did today. You really stepped it up, and we appreciate it. And thanks to the mayor and to all the people behind the scenes who are working for this, particularly all the advocates. We will celebrate, and we will thank you publicly, and we will also come back and say we need you as our partners to figure out how we get the rest of the way. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Tam Purnell, followed by Donald Smith. Tam Purnell. Okay. Donald Smith, followed by Kim Trueheart.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Donald Smith. I live in the sixth council, second councilmatic district. Also, I believe the sixth councilmatic district as a dual homeowner in Baltimore City, a taxpayer and a non-voter here in Baltimore City. We have a problem in this city. We have a gang problem. The police is a gang. The preachers are a gang. The business community are a gang. And this body that we are before this evening is a gang. And they have all ganged up on the citizens of Baltimore City. The problem that we have is that now that there was a so-called uprising and our children was attacked by the police department, it seems that we want to move from that into solutions. But there's a middle section there that no one wished to address of how these communities came to be. Well, how the hood doesn't look good. And one thing we have to address that this body has done over the years since the time of Willie Don Schaefer has divested from the black communities and have refocused and rechanneled those monies to downtown development, to folks like billionaires like Kevin Plack, who sits on the Forbes list of 400 billionaires in this country. These are wealthy people. They can finance their own projects and their own development. This body and those previous to this body are responsible for the lives that have been lost in Baltimore City. And it's about time that this body be responsible. If you say that Black Lives Matter, then you have to show it, because it seems that our children are going downtown to the Inner Harbor because they know where the good stuff is, because those things down there is not in their neighborhoods. Mr. Welch, in your district, you have 47% of the people in your district are renters. You have the bulk of the boarded up homes. Your community doesn't even have a library that our children could be able to take books home and places for them to socialize. This body should stand indicted for the decimation of Black communities, segregated and hyper-segregated Black communities here in Baltimore City. You have to listen to what the people have to say and not follow the dictates of those that finance your campaigns, like the Greater Baltimore Committee.
Kim Trueheart, followed by Taisha Blair.
Okay, 2 minutes is not enough. And that shows the disrespect that you have for the citizenry of Baltimore. But see, I ain't gonna go there and dwell on that, because you already know that you've disrespected us, and it's not gonna continue. This $2.549 billion budget has not changed the trajectory for our children or the residents. 33% goes to the police department. About 20% goes to the human services that are desperately needed by the poor folks in the city. Let me say it again. 33% goes to the police department. They got a plus up of $22 million this year. And you're gonna pat yourselves on the back because you gave our children 4.2 today? Don't you dare. Don't you even think about applauding yourselves for not serving the children, for not serving the poor. You don't know what it means to legislate on behalf of the citizens, because you've never done it in the 5 years I've been here. As far as I'm concerned, when you say 2% goes to social services and 2% goes to rec centers, but 33% goes to the police, I don't understand your math. I do not. Have you looked? The world has seen how Baltimore looks. The world has seen how we have two Baltimores, and you sit there. You sit there and have the audacity to think you did something today. Y'all all need to go, all of you. And I'm gonna run some candidates against each and every one of you. I will back them. I will shout on the mountaintops on their behalf, because not one of you has served the citizens. Baltimore is 63% Black, and every Black person in this city is struggling. Everyone, because of the bureaucratic craziness that you vote for every year. Every year. You should have doubled after school funding. Doubled. It was $4.8 million when this mayor took office. Doubled it. You should have doubled the $6 million that was budgeted for this year to $12 million. That would have been triumphant. Get off your butts and do your job and serve the people. It is outrageous that the police department got $22 million more this year. And then the commissioner goes on TV this week and says, I need
vehicles.
Yes, I know, and I will ask you to indulge me for 30 seconds more, please. I think it is outrageous that you let the police commissioner get on TV and say he wanted to buy $51,000 vehicles to lock us up. $51,000 vehicle. And you're gonna give it to him, I know it. Because every daggone thing that man asks for, you give him. And why? Not to make us safer, but whom are you trying to make safer?
Taisha Blair, followed by Ayanna Jenkins.
It needs to stop. It needs to stop.
Hello, my name is Taisha Blair. I just bought a house in the 11th district. I bought my house of August last year. I have not moved in it yet, but yet my water bill is about $215 every quarter. And I haven't washed the dish, I haven't flushed the toilet, I haven't done anything. So I called the Baltimore City Water Department and they pretty much told me that was the minimum. How that's the minimum, I have no idea when I haven't used any water. So I feel like if any of you are seeking re-election, you need to bring some resolution to reducing these bills. Thank you.
That's right. Ayanna Jenkins, followed by Shelly Higgins. Ayanna Jenkins, followed by Shelly Higgins.
Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
First, I would like to say thank you for this opportunity to stand in front of you. I actually live in District 3. I've lived in District 3 all of my life. I bought a house in District 3 about 6 years ago. But I'm not here to talk about where I live. I'm here to talk about the recent layoffs in Baltimore City Public Schools. It's my understanding that this council has to approve the budget for Baltimore City Public Schools. I'm one of the 59 school-based staff that was laid off on May 29th, about 2:30. The manager of labor and relations came to my school to let me know that, oh, you don't have a job effective June 30th, period. When I questioned them about this, he said that the seniority rule applied, which means that they put everybody in my classification in a list, and based on however amount of money Baltimore City Public Schools is trying to save, I didn't make the cut. However, I did my own research. There were several people that were hired after me that did not receive a layoff letter. So did you come to me and lie to me blatantly to my face? I have a son that's in college that went through Baltimore City Public Schools, and I have a two-year-old who I'm not sure she'll attend Baltimore City Public Schools because of this foolishness, for lack of better words. So you come to me, tell me I don't have a job, and again, I did the research, and at least five people who were hired after me, I'm repeating this for a reason, still have their jobs to date. Quickly, I have about 30 seconds because the red thing is up. Another concern is that I'm the business manager at my school. So I work with my principal in the budget process. My position is funded for the next school year. So why did I receive a layoff letter? Again, my position is in the budget for next school year, but I don't have a job in 2 weeks. Thank you.
Shelly Higgins, followed by Katie Call. Shelly Higgins, followed by Katie Call.
Thank you. Good evening.
Ms. Higgins.
All right, good evening. Thank you for having me. My name is Shelly Higgins, and I'm representing District 9. I work in Baltimore City Public Schools. I work at Excel Academy, and I'm here to piggyback on what Ayanna just said, but I wanted to speak on a more broader scale in reference to our cities and the employees who work there. I've been working at the same school. It's an alternative school for 14 years now, and in that time, I've seen a lot of CEOs come and go, and as they're coming and going, there's a lot of changes that happen within that time frame. And what I have a problem with is I notice that every single time, if there's any ineptness in terms of, you know, the spending or, you know, deficit or whatever it is, budget shortfall, It's always the city students and the dedicated employees who end up suffering. And my question is, when are we gonna see this stop? We now have Dr. Thornton, who has come in. You know, he's pretty much pulled all our funding from our school. Again, I work at an alternative high school. We need as much hands on deck there, because we are talking about students who are, you know, in, basically they are, you know, high dropouts, and they also been, you know, sent from other schools, but yet since our budget has been pulled, but yet since they sat there and approved a budget that took all our entire budget away from us, and, you know, we don't know what we're gonna be working with next year. So we want some answers in reference to that, and we want also to see that they stop, stop punishing dedicated employees and the students of the city under the guise that, oh, we're doing this for the students. Thank you.
Katie Call, followed by Alana Purvis.
Hello, I'm here specifically to speak on behalf of Monarch Academy and Mr. Bratcher, who is the current director of administration's and registration, I'm sorry. I am a mother of two boys at Monarch Academy, and I am proud of all of our students. They are not just my own two sons. And I'm a former preschool teacher in Harford County, so I know both sides of the system, and I know that in the system there are keystone people that make the school work, and one of those people is Mr. Bratcher. He is there every day, and he goes beyond the call of his job. He is there as a role model for the students. He shows stability, even through all the events that happened in April. Our young students were very upset about it, and he was there every day to show them keep pushing forward and keep striving. And I think that after events in April, that we know we need to put more money and more resources into our system and into our children. It is the only way to get back on our feet and show the nation that Baltimore is beautiful and we care about the next generation. The most important resource that I have seen in the city is sitting right there in the corner, and that is Mr. Bratcher, and he deserves to stay, and the kids of Monarch Academy deserve to have him. Thank you.
Alana Purvis, followed by Sarah Hines.
Hi, good evening. My name is Alana Purvis, and I'm a third grade teacher at Monarch Academy Public Charter, and I'm here to also appeal the elimination of Mr. Bratcher's position. Mr. Jarrell Bratcher is one of the most hardworking, caring, and dedicated individuals I have ever encountered. I've worked professionally in various occupations, but I have never encountered anyone who lives by any means necessary to provide support for students, parents, and teachers alike. Jarrell has been a part of the Monarch Academy well before day one, and we are just finishing up year four now. Mr. Bratcher knows the students, parents, teachers, family, and loved ones so very well. The city always stresses that we need to strive and foster positive relationships with families. Well, Mr. Bratcher has done that and continues to surpass that expectation. Mr. Bratcher has put in countless hours, both at work and at home, without pay, to go above and beyond for our school, yet has not once asked for anything in return. Mr. Bratcher goes above and beyond every day to help teachers with whatever they need, be it supplies, materials, technology issues, protocol, support students who are having a rough day, taking them for a break, calming them down. If we have a special event in our school, there's no one to set up or turn to, Mr. Bratcher is there. We know as educators that we are required to wear many different hats on a daily basis. Mr. Bratcher does not hesitate. Whatever students need, he's there. Whatever parents need, he's there. Whatever teachers need, he's there. Whatever I need, he's there. Mr. Bratcher is the epitome of selflessness and lives by our mission of serving a cause greater than oneself. This school truly, truly needs Mr. Bratcher there, as he is one of our monarch wings and he helps us soar. Thank you.
Sarah Hines, followed by Goldie Watkins.
Hello, my name is Sarah Hines. I'm a teacher at a second grade teacher at Monarch Academy as well, and I'm also here to protest the elimination of Jarrell Bratcher's position. I'm not gonna be too repetitive, but I just wanted to make a couple of points besides the ones that have already been made. I have been working there for 2 years now. When I originally applied for the position, the person that I first spoke to on the phone was Mr. Bratcher. The person who answered all my emails was Mr. Bratcher. The person who met me at the front desk was Mr. Bratcher. He would be on the intercom while I was there. He is the face and the voice that I put to Monarch. He's been there since the beginning of the school. Also, I think that it's important to note that his position is the one that's being eliminated. However, his position had to be split into three positions this past year. He was doing the work of three people, so they needed to add two other positions in order to keep up with all of the work that he was doing. So if we're talking about seniority being criteria, he was definitely one of the first positions at Monarch, and he did the work of at least three people, and I would argue more than that. As one of our other teachers said, he helps teachers, parents, and students alike, as well as the administration. So I personally don't know how he does all of the work that he does, and I think it's important that someone who's as dedicated as he is gets to stay in his position. And that's all. Thank you.
Goldie Watkins, followed by Jarrell Hatcher. Bratcher. Goldie Watkins.
I'm Goldie Watkins, and I'm in Mount Washington and have been for 25 years. I am a taxpayer and have been, I guess, for 45 years in a different section of the city. I was surprised when
pull,
I found...
Pull the microphone down.
Okay.
Yeah.
There? It's better?
Much better.
Did you hear the first part? Okay. I was surprised when... on May the 30th, I found that there's a proposal for real property tax increase. And just driving through my community, I see where so many houses are going up now for sale. The other thing is, it's not said why there should be a tax increase. I like to know where the money is going. And it says it's beginning July the 1st, 2015, if it happens. And I don't think that that's enough time. The other thing is, I don't have snow removal in my community. I don't have street cleaning. I have tons of potholes through Mount Washington. And I just feel like it's just ridiculous. Plus the fact I haven't talked about children, the juveniles, the delinquency, because of not enough recreation, the libraries, and things of that nature. I just think this whole thing needs to be rethought. And that's my concerns.
Ms. Watkins, we will, as a point of clarification, that it's not a real property tax increase. It is a constant yield. And so what happens is it's based upon the revenue that comes in, but it's a constant yield and not a true property increase.
But it's going to be more money involved. And it's not stated where the money is going. And I have property in other states. And the increase isn't like a yearly thing.
Okay. 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 Councilman Henry will.
If your councilperson is here, when you're done, if I can step outside.
Yeah, that's fine.
But the constant yield. Just a minute. Wait, hello. We're gonna have Mr. Andrew Klein, the Director of Budget Bureau Management Research, explain that the constant yield is not an increase.
I haven't seen the communication, but there's no change in the property tax rate. There's no change in the property tax rate for 2016.
But explain the difference in the yield.
I haven't seen the communication that she was referring to, but there's no change in the rate.
It has to do with the assessment.
If your assessment increased, then you would the amount you pay would go up. Yes.
Yes. How can the assessment go when you property tax go when you
Yeah, if you had a, if you have the homestead tax credit, then your assessment could go down and your tax rate would continue to go up because the amount that your rate can go up is capped each year.
But everybody doesn't have homestead tax. So. And certain neighborhoods have 2.26 tax rate and the black community has 2.26.
Okay. Well, if you want to speak with Mr. Klein afterwards for your particular case.
You told a lie. You're the one that said, you're the one that said it wasn't no increase.
It is not. It is not an increase. It is not. Miss Wimbish.
It is an increase. It's your lie. You fix it.
Jarrell Bratcher.
Not an increase.
Followed by Priscilla Batten.
Get those margaritas. Oh no.
It was him.
Margarita.
Please.
If he would have, if it would have worked, he'd have been like,
okay.
Mr. Bratcher.
All right. I won't be long. I need to throw out some love deposits. I know you all are getting hurled with a lot of darts, but these folks here are actually some friends of mine. These are constituents that I've worked with. Their mothers, their fathers, their aunts, their uncles, their cousins, and they're also friends of mine, and they have stood and supported me in many other issues. Don't count that towards my time. I just need to throw that out there. My name is Jarrell Bratcher, and I'm a young, hardworking, tax-paying citizen of Baltimore. I'm thankful for the invitation and the unwavering support of City Councilwoman Mary Pat Clark, City Councilwoman Helen Holton, the Education and Youth Committee, the CHUM community, the City Council President and the Baltimore City Council, the Mayor's Office, the Maryland General Assembly, the Office of the Secretary of Education, Arna Duncan, the Office of the Attorney General, Senators John Ray Salling, Bill Ferguson, Dolores Kelly, the elected officials of Districts 46, 43, 41, the Children's Guild, the operator of our charter, the parents, students, teachers, and staff of Monarch Academy Public Charter School. The Baltimore City Public School District has decided to cut my position from Monarch Academy effective June 30th, 2015, with the reason being due to the district's budget constraints and not a reflection of my performance or employability. This happened against the wishes of our school's principal, leadership team, and the operator of our charter school. The upsetting and shocking part is that my principal already budgeted for me to continue in my position for the next school year and did not intend to cut my position. Again, I say the sad, unfair, and inequitable part is that my job and position came out of fair student funding, which is supposed to be untouched and safe from the layoffs. We are a charter school, and my principal budgeted for my position for the next school year. Just last week, our principal mentioned that she would be resigning at the end of the school year. So after many unanswered emails that were sent to the leaders of Baltimore City Public Schools, please spare me some time, just about 45 more seconds. The Office of Human Capital through Baltimore City Public Schools to appeal and overturn this decision to eliminate my position without a substantiated cause. The CEO of Baltimore City Public Schools boasts and brags about having the interests of our students when he stated, we will be organized and aligned to best support schools in meeting the needs of every student. Or when he says, we are committed to providing a safe, supportive climate throughout our schools. But I disagree, especially at times like this, when he decides to lay off hardworking staff and dedicated young African-American males, such as myself, without the insight, input of administrators, teachers, students, families at each individual school, who are being positive role models to our young males who live in homes absent of fathers, young males who are absent or tardy more than they are present, young males who live in environments with fatherless families and no father-like figures, young males who carry the weight and the burden of single parent households where their mother, sister, grandmother, aunt, or uncle are sick and tired and stressed. Young males who, while they are yet young, have to be parents to their younger siblings.
Mr. Bratcher, you're out of time. We have it in writing. Thank you.
I think you get my point.
Thank you. Priscilla Batten, followed by Edna Lawrence.
Okay, my name's Priscilla Batten, and I am.
Talk right into the microphone, please.
Can you hear me now? Okay, my name's Priscilla Batten. I'm also a resident of Mount Washington. Lived there about 25 years as well. And as a resident of Baltimore City, I feel that I pay some of the highest property taxes in this state. Whenever I talk with anyone in any other county, they are astounded by how much money I pay in property tax. I work a lot of jobs as a widow, trying to maintain and keep my own property. And I will say that a 2% increase is a significant increase for me. I'm sure it's a significant increase for even more so for people who have families. The street that I live on, as Goldie stated, we get no services. There will be, it doesn't sound like we're getting any extra services. I don't understand what this increase is for. The pattern has been to close recreation centers, to close the libraries, to close and stop the art programs and all that at the schools. And so now we've done all of that, and now we're gonna raise property taxes. I thought that most of the platforms that were run on were to decrease the taxes in the property taxes in the city of Baltimore, and what I'm seeing is more so increasing the taxes. Also, I will say that by increasing taxes, one of the things that's going to happen, and this already happens, is that we have young people who move into the city. They're singles, or couples, I should say. They start having children, and as soon as they have children, they leave because the taxes are so high, because the school systems are not great, and the crime rate, and all of the other stuff. So my suggestion would be think about that loss of income. And let's see, is there anything else? I think that's it, but I don't want to see any increases in my property tax. Fifth, Mount Washington.
Fifth District. Edna Lawrence, followed by Travis Robertson.
Well, I'm just going to hold the mic because I'm short. Good evening, council, men and ladies. I'm Grandmother Edna Lawrence, and I have a 30-year upstanding positive record in Baltimore City. We, the African-American tourism, heritage, entertainment, Black Business Community Commission. We have presented a bill to Congress, to Councilman Stokes, Councilwoman Holton, Councilwoman Middleton. Our bill is supposed to be in review. We are asking, we are demanding that we be included in the funding that Visit Baltimore constantly received on the backs of 60% of the African-American community, because without our business, our historic sites, Mr. Klein, you would not have a Visit Baltimore. So we are asking that our commission be kept in review and reconsidered funding, because we are Visit Baltimore. Visit Baltimore rides on the backtails of every Black historical district in Baltimore City. Let me not start with Sandtown, the Pennsylvania Avenue Historic District, the Inner Harbor, Fells Point. If you check your records and you look at them really well, you'll see that every building that's considered blight is a Black historic district that has been robbed of all this funding because it's going to the entertainment district that's blanketing off the backs of the Black. And I am an entertainer in Baltimore City, and I perform in the downtown communities of Baltimore, and I live in the 11th district. So I function all over Baltimore City. I've been doing programs in the school system for 20 years. So I'm asking that we be allowed to share Visit Baltimore's horrendous budget money, because we are the historic entertainers in Baltimore City, because we are the Black Baltimore community of businesses and entertainment here in the state of Maryland. Thank you.
Travis Robertson, followed by Diana Sell.
My name is Travis Robertson. I'm a law student, community advocate, mentor, and tutorer. And I'm from District 9.
Pull the mic back up. Yeah, talk right into the
mic. I'm from District 9, Pete Wells District. I don't see any kind of community development, economic development in my community, and that is a shame. It's evident that our city is in a crisis, and y'all need to understand that more chaos will come if y'all don't get some brain cells from somewhere and focus on community development, vacant housing, economic development, jobs for ex-felons, and these young men and women who don't have hope. Our kids need quality education, rec centers, after-school programs, and they don't need a youth jail. And I'm with Ms. Trueheart. Y'all need to take at least 10, 20% of that 33% and open back up these PAL centers. And Mr. I got something for you too, Mr. Jack Young. Our community needs police who will patrol, protect, and serve our community respectfully. And just wanna let y'all know 2016 is coming. Y'all think it's a joke, but it ain't no joke. We can't get you out of office. You told me, Mr. Jack Young, that you always get 83% of the vote, which means you think that was very cocky of you to say that, because you think that, oh, people just gonna vote for me. No, people are tired, okay? And just like we got Bernstein out of office, we can get you out of office too. It only takes 40,000 to 50,000 votes to get you out of office. And Mr. Pete Welch, we can get you out of office too, because it's a shame that you live, I think the block you live in near Marbury, and Curry, well, it's still your district. It's still your district. I think your mom used to live in that block. The block looked like a war zone hit. It's five vacant houses in that block. In your district, there are over about 400 to 500 more vacant houses in your district. That's a shame. You've been in office for how many years? You've been in office for how many years?
We're not here he's to not answer questions,
he's
Mr.
not. He's
Robertson.
Not. No, I'm just no. Yeah, he needs to respond because it's sad. Y'all think y'all got your little positions, and y'all think y'all can have your little position. I'm not worried about that because I pay taxes. Y'all think y'all got your little positions now, but 2016 is coming. We will vote y'all out.
Diana Sell, followed by Cindy Farquhar.
Good evening. My name is Diana Sell, and I'm an employee of Baltimore City Public Schools, and I work at William Packer Elementary School 83. On May 29th, I was also one of the employees that was told that I would no longer have a job effective June 30th, with the only explanation given was due to seniority. Just like the young lady who spoke earlier, there were people hired after me. I don't understand how, if it's a seniority issue, how I'm losing my job before people who were hired into William Packer after me. I was in the real estate business for 25 years, and I decided to make a change in my career, and it was either medical field or education, and I chose education. I feel for the children of this city. I, too, was homeless when I was young. I went hungry. I have a mission, and my mission is to help the children of Baltimore City, to give them some hope, to give them some direction. I work hours upon hours with no pay. I don't ask for anything. I'm the baseball coach of the team for our school. I come in and paint on the weekends and don't ask for a penny. I feel that the way that this went about, being that my position was also funded in the Fair Student Funding, that we are owed a little bit more of an explanation as to why we, who also have families, will no longer have a job come June 30th. I feel that we are more than just a number, and I hope that that is taken into consideration. Thank you.
Cindy Farquhar, followed by Annika Ellis.
Thank you. Council President and council members and everyone that's here tonight. And I'm speaking also for David Yaffe about the library. He has done a statistical report on different public libraries. The two recommendations are, number one, that Baltimore City fund the library better, less stringently, and number two, that actual funding be withheld until the library performs better in the jobs that it's supposed to perform. But let me at first say, of course, that there's great praise to go to the library for staying open at Penn in Pennsylvania and North during the uprising. And also the library does well in reference transactions, in librarians answering questions, in attendance at public meetings, and in numerous author visits. However, what it does poorly compared to Gary, Indiana, Birmingham, Alabama, St. Louis, and Milwaukee is hours open, size of collection per capita expenditure to increase the collection, percent of people with library cards, circulation per capita, how often each item circulates on average, use of materials within the library, and visits to the library per capita. And this poor performance has gone on for 30 years. This is not new. Pratt has kept its libraries open 35 hours per week, and St. Louis 56. Pratt's total collection amounts to 4.04 items for each Baltimore City residence. St. Louis 10.59. Pratt's cardholders equal 17% of Baltimore City's people. Gary's 108, which obviously includes non-residents, have library cards. Why doesn't every single child get a library card? They're very lately beginning that program for first graders now, but that's insane not to have that as part of a child's school experience. Library users annually use materials at the rate of 0.59 per resident in Baltimore and the rate of 9.85 in Birmingham. What could we learn? Therefore, the recommendation is that the council set up an intensive study of, I have some papers to leave with you, of course, but they've been sent to the members anyway, but that they set up an intensive study, and then that study would be paid for many times over by the information that it would find from others, because the library administration is not doing their job in this regard. Thank you.
Anita Ellis, and then Katrina Loudon.
Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes, ma'am.
The point that brought me out tonight was the layoffs of some of your Baltimore City Public School staff. But understand that I'm not here just to support their positions. I'm here as a parent supporting my children. Baltimore City Public School System was not doing right by my children as far as the curriculum. Charter schools were a better option for those of us working class families who are affected by property taxes, who are affected by all of the other elements that come into living with the city, as an option for our children to get a better education. Why charter school works is the curriculum, the climate, and the staff. I can only speak about what I know. My children are students at Monarch Academy, and Monarch Academy is fueled in large part by Mr. Bratcher. He's been everything that those students and those staff needed from day one. I'm part of what they call the founding families, meaning my children began first year of the inception of Monarch Academy Baltimore campus. They've moved locations 3 times, and I stayed because of the staff, because they're not just there as staff, they're there as support. They're there to be, in a lot of cases, supplemental parents for those children that need that. And I think that if there are cuts to be made, there are cuts to be made. But if you're going to make those cuts, consider not just going by seniority. I happen to be an employee of the state of Maryland, and to be honest, there's too much job security for people behind the guise of seniority who don't actually do their job. Consider the content of their work ethic. And if you consider that, I'm confident that Mr. Bratcher's name will be removed from your list of those who no longer have employment, just like the other young ladies who spoke today.
Thank you, Ms. Ellis. Katrina Loudon. Katrina Loudon, followed by Linwood Tyson.
I'm here today on behalf of Mr. Bratchett, and all I have to say is, with Mr. Bratchett gone from that school and you bringing someone new in there, the school is like going to go down, it's going to start all over again. Mr. Bratchett is the glue to that school. He's like Flash Gordon. He's standing in front of you talking 1 minute, he knows every child in that school, and the next minute he's gone and he's right back in your face. Any problem, any issue, anything going on with that school, Mr. Bratchett lets you know. It doesn't matter what time, day, or night. If you need anyone, you can call Mr. Bratchett along with any other teacher in that school. If you let go, Mr. Bratchett, look at your jobs. And someone come in and tell you, I'm letting you go. Y'all just let people go like it doesn't even matter. Their jobs matter to them and this city of Baltimore, these schools. You want to start other schools, you want to put up a juvenile jail, all this money for a juvenile jail, and you don't care about other people's jobs. The kids that you are taking Mr. Bratchett from, these kids, they're going to be the ones that y'all are going to put in that jail. So is that what you're building a jail for? Take that money, cut some of your pay. Do that, cut some of your pay to keep some of these teachers in these schools. Y'all keep talking about we don't have anything, we don't have it. Look how much money you bring home. Look at where you live at, 3 and 4 and 5 houses. They struggle to stay there and they're there day and night. When they go home, they're still talking about these kids. So if you let Mr. Bratchett go and any other teacher that you decide to let go, you need to think 2 to 3 times before you do it. 2 to 3 times before you do it. Thank you.
Hello, name is Linwood Tyson, and I'm from the Radicate Avenue, Sedonia area. And my main concern that for tonight is to, first let me say, to the city council president and everybody else, you know, I'm here. But my concern is right now is this. The first time here, and I hear a lot of different things, but I've been living in my house for 29 years, been paid for, it's almost paid for. And every time I turn around, my taxes is going up and my property value is going down. Now somebody needs to explain to me how I work all of my life to buy property in Baltimore City to try to enhance the city. And every time I turn around, I'm paying more, more, more. And like me, when you retire, everybody here know it. When you retire, you don't have that money like that. So where is this money going to come from? How do I keep my property? And how do we do something about these young people that don't have no jobs? Now we're talking about problems in the city, taxes. Another big problem that we got, and it's not going to go away. And the city better get quick and start some quick responses quick. For $33 million, like you say, for the police department, you're going to need 3 times the police to control this city. Thank you.
Thank you. Janet, is this Blair or Black? Followed by, it looked like Jorian Thomas. Okay, you can go ahead.
Hello. In 2012, when President Obama went to Charlotte, North Carolina, the city went all out and doubled everybody's taxes. Ours went from $1,500 to $3,000 because he came to the city and they needed money. But they did listen. The people who run Charlotte listened. And the next year, we got paperwork from them asking us how much we thought this house was worth. Now, this is a grandfather house. My father never did much with it, but my brothers want to keep it. We filled the papers out and sent it back, and lo and behold, we got money back from the city with interest for the overcharge. They asked us what we thought it was worth, let us do the research, we sent it in, they looked at whatever they had to look at, and they lowered the taxes. That's a city that listens to people, and I think that that is absolutely fair. So I hope that you will listen now when I tell you, if this city has, let's say, 10,000 liquor stores, you divide the city in half, the white side maybe got 1,000, the black side got 9,000. So all of those liquor stores that got burnt out, you need to try to do whatever you can to keep them from opening up. The corner of Smallwood and North Avenue smells better, looks better than it ever has in my 30 years being there. Don't let Fireside open back up. I know it's a tricky thing. There's a lot of Koreans in the city, and I know they got a lot of money. But this has to stop. We got too many liquor stores, and y'all know it.
Juvian Thomas is the last person who has signed in to testify.
Good evening, council members. My name is Juvian Thomas, and I'm here to speak on behalf of Monarch Academy and also Mr. Bradshaw. I have been a foster parent and a parent. I've had children into the regular elementary school, middle school, high school, and also private school. And I found Monarch Academy a great school for many reasons. And also my son, Jaden, which is standing here, is a part of that school. When he found out that Mr. Brasher is leaving, it was very sad for him. Why? Because he had a personal relationship with Mr. Brasher, because Mr. Brasher is a type of person that is very personable to everyone, whether it's a parent, a teacher, a child. I have been on the PTA board in the past, and he's there late at night, early in the morning he's there, and whenever you make a phone call to him, even at home on the weekend, he's answering that phone. It's about the student and the parent. Now, I know that I'm very important. You know why? Because when you want the vote, you call me. You knock at my door. So here today I'm speaking because you need me, also he needs me. And I'm speaking today because I'm asking and beseeching and begging. I'm here today, my job is on the line. I just got notice that December I will be out of a job. I work for the state as well. But I'm not about me today. Because my child is my future. He's the future of this country, the state, and that's who I'm invested in today. So I'm asking, if you want great minds, great people, I'm asking to let Mr. Bradshaw remain in his place. Thank you.
Mary Whitten? Whitley? Mary Whitley?
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm coming to please ask that Baltimore City Public School System reevaluate removing Mr. Bratcher from Monarch Academy. Baltimore City School System has made several questionable decisions in recent years in regarding our children's education. I am a product of Baltimore City Public Schools. However, in recent years, they have proposed to close my elementary alma mater, which is Abiston Elementary. I moved my grandchild from Abiston to Monarch Academy when Monarch started. And Mr. Bratcher has been there. He has been a viable part of that school community. My grandchildren have excelled at Monarch. I think that if we really want to invest in our future and we really want to make prominent citizens that will be able to replace you all in the coming years, then we need to leave administrators like Mr. Bratcher at Monarch Academy and really take a close look at the schools that are producing students that have not only academic excellence, but they also have social excellence. This school doesn't have all of the behavior problems that most of the schools have because they teach their students to be fair in government, to find ultimate means of resolving their issues, and the children feel good about having an active part. Mr. Bratcher takes an active part in seeing that these children are a part of this school community, and this school has really done wonders. Please, please, please leave him there. He's the last of the founding members there from Monarch Academy, and Monarch Academy is doing wonders with our children and their education. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to thank you all for coming out this evening. That is everyone that has signed up. Oh, one more. Okay, one moment. If you would come give us your name, since I don't have the sheet.
I'm Ryan Dorsey. I'm a lifelong resident of the 3rd District. I figured while I was here, I ought to say something about something that probably matters. We got this rec center, the North Hartford Playfield in my district that has been closed since 2009. The baseball team, the league that I played on as a kid, has not existed since 2005. So this is essentially public space that's not serving anybody in any way. There is one basketball court there that has one rim half a foot below or lower than the other. It's the only outdoor full court in the area, so kids won't even play a full court game on it because it's unfair to one side. I've observed seventh graders who go to school directly across the street from the nearest functional rec center, walking a mile after school to come and play on this court, only to be pushed off when older kids come along. The asphalt of the tennis courts there is essentially rendering those courts unplayable, not that there are nets on them anyway. There apparently were many other assets there in the past that lifelong residents, as we have in this district, the 3rd District, where people tend to stay and for generations in many cases, remember this as a place where kids grew up essentially hanging at these rec centers and having a safe place to be. And I guess I'd just like to see some reinvestment in this particular site, the North Hartford Playfield. That's all.
Thank you. We'd like to thank you all for coming out this evening. Your comments have been heard, and the members of the City Council appreciate you. Okay. Christiana Johnson, followed by Bridget Thompson.
Good evening. My name is Christiana Johnson, and I'm also one of the founding families of Monarch Academy School. I'm here on behalf of Mr. Bratchett. Mr. Bratchett is the oil to the engine of Monarch Academy.
Can you speak right into the...
Mr. Bratchett is the oil to the engine of Monarch Academy. If you were to remove him from his position, it would not be in the best interest of our children. He wears many hats at our school, including being a role model, a father figure to most of the children there. So I'm asking you, no, I'm begging you, not to eliminate his position. Thank you.
Bridget Thompson, followed by Jaheim Boulding.
Good evening.
Pull the microphone close to you, yeah.
Good evening. I just wanted to come here to let you all know the importance of Mr. Bratcher. You have heard a lot about him. One of the important things I want you to know that the support that he offers to the teachers and the staff is unmeasurable. The weekends, the evenings. This is a gentleman that no matter what, what's going on, he's there. He's there for, like I said, the teachers, the students, if they just need someone to talk to, and that can't go away. It should not go away, and we are just asking that you please revisit that decision and to just support not only him, but all other supports in the school system, because they serve an important role. You know, the teachers are in the classroom, and sometimes they just need some support, whether that's someone to make sure that the report cards are processed, which is important, to make sure that when, as far as hiring, dealing with the district office, he's that person that actually follows through those emails, making sure that those, you know, as far as the paperwork is processed on time, enrollments, emergency contact information, that's important to the day-to-day operation of the school. And without him there, we just wouldn't know what to do. Thank you.
Jaheim Boulding, followed by Michelle Austin.
Hello, I'm a student that go to Mark Academy, Baltimore campus, and I would like for Mr. Bratcher to stay because Mr. Bratcher has been an important role in my academic process and many other students. because Mr. Brecht actually cares about the kids, and he goes the extra step to actually talk to the kids and see how they're doing. And it's kind of like someone cares actually about your education, because some people say their teachers, they don't care, they're just getting paid. But Mr. Brecht and a lot of teachers at my school, they care, and they have had no important role in a lot of kids' behavioral process and academic. That's it.
Michelle Austin.
Good afternoon. My name is Michelle Austin. I'm from Digital Harbor, School 416. And I'm up here to speak to you all in reference to the letter that we received on May the 29th. I think it was about five of us that received the letter. Been in the school system 78 years. Then on top of it, we find out that we only gonna get paid one for every 4 days of our time, leave time that we have. I don't think that's fair, because we didn't ask for leave. I feel as though we still have families that we have to provide for. That's our livelihood. We have no one reached out to us that told us anything. Then we have, some of us have certification for different positions that we reached out to the school board for. No one contacted us yet. It's been over a week. I'm one of them, have a certification for a paraeducator. Sent all the emails over, haven't heard anything. I don't think that's fair, because that's our livelihood. And what are we supposed to do after that time? So if you all could do anything in your powers to help with our situation, we would really appreciate it.
We would like to thank you all for coming out this evening. Your comments have been heard by members of the City Council, and we appreciate you taking the time to come out and share your thoughts on this budget. The City Council will consider the adoption of the fiscal year 2015 tax rate at the next meeting of the City Council on Monday, June 15th at 3 p.m. At this time, I'd like to thank everyone for coming tonight, and have a safe evening. We will be closing the room shortly and ask that everyone exit promptly to the first floor main entrance. Once more, thank you for visiting City Hall.